Kandi and I'm here for Southern African Connection. Today we're here live at Africa Day, a day organized by the area ambassadors and embassies to celebrate African culture. So today we're going to hear speeches, see entertainment, and hear a lot of information about Africa. We hope you enjoy the show.
From Africa, we are now going to ask everybody to stand up.
What so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched.
Please continue standing for the African Union National Anthem.
Thank you.
policy for that.
Ambassador Inga Thomas-Greenfield, the Assistant Secretary of State for Africa, the U.S. State Department, and the senior officials from the State Department and the government, Your Lordship the Mayor of D.C., Your Excellency the Dean of the Diplomatic Corps, are you here? Where are you, our Dean? Oh, yeah. Your Excellency, Amina Salum Ali, Ambassador of the African Union to the United States, Ubo. Are you there? Your Excellency, the older diabetic ambassador of Cote d'Ivoire and chairman of the African group, are you there? Right. Your Excellency, Fidem Tifu, deputy dean of the Diplomatic Corps, I hope for. That is Fidem Tifu. My fellow co-chair, Ambassador Mathilde of Mukantabana. Upo! Your Excellencies, Ambassadors, our distinguished guests, welcome. Our friends, the friends of Africa and partners, are you there? Welcome. So without much ado, I want to thank you all for coming, and it's my hope that you will have a lovely night. And it's a night full of music, full of dance. You have all to be on the floor. Thank you very much. And we say in Tanzania, asanteni sana na karibuni. Thank you very much.
Excellencies, we are happy to have you here. My sister has said most of the things that I was going to say to welcome you, but I'll give a couple of remarks. It's a pleasure for us to welcome you to the Africa Day. As we celebrate our day, we are committed to our shared goal to solidify Africa's unity. And we salute you. We salute all the people who have been with us on this journey. Today, Africa's population is slightly above 1 billion people, and the youth is comprising about 60% of the population. This upsurge of the population is a challenge, but also a big opportunity, as we report about 40% in 2050 are going to be workforce from Africa.
Stand up for Africa. I have chosen to defend my history, protect my land, eliminate the perpetrators and their wickedness, and declare peace in the name of justice. Let us not forget that Africa is the richest continent in natural resources, from gold to diamond, rubber to copper, timber to oil. Africa is widely known. Tourism industry. Africa exports tea, coffee, just to name a few. Africa is beautifully endowed with the Great Rift Valley, the Victoria Falls, the pyramids, the oceans, the seas, and even its people. And now, 80% of the world's supply of coltan, a mineral that is used to manufacture cell phones, computers, PlayStations, in the whole world is found in Africa. Tell me, what darkness comes from all this light? I have a dream that one day we shall find a cure to HIV and AIDS and rid our continent of this dreaded disease. I dream that one day our children shall teach the Western children our culture instead of it being vice versa. I have a dream that one day all the African heads of states will come together, speak in one voice, and together form and create one country, one continent. The United States of
Africa!
The United States of
Africa!
So listen to our mothers and our fathers calling. For when Mama Africa calls.
One more round of applause for Anna Malandro. Asante sana Anna.
The U.S. and African relationship is strong. It's moving, continuing to move in a positive direction. But still, as all of you ambassadors here know, my door and my office is always open to all of you to receive you. My staff and I are always available to hear your ideas, your recommendations on how to make our relationship stronger. The theme of this year's Africa Day event is agriculture and food security. To me, this is a topic that really hits the root causes of poverty and hunger on the continent. More importantly, it also highlights the need for significant investment in Africa's agricultural sector. According to the State Department's Office of Global Food Initiative, Global Food Security, the demands of growing populations, the impact of climate change, and the limitations on water and natural resources affect sustainability of investments in agricultural development and food security. It impedes long-term economic growth, limits livelihoods, and reduces overall well-being. Since many Africans depend directly on climate-sensitive economic activities such as agriculture and fisheries, the ripple effects that impact economic growth and cross-sector development are significant. U.S.-African strategic partnership like Feed the Future, the Global Climate Change Initiative, the forthcoming USG8 New Alliance for Food Security and Nutrition, all are committed to addressing these challenges and developing Africa's agricultural sector.
Chigamba and Chinyakare Ensemble. Karibuni.
Investing in agriculture. Of the 10 in the world, six are African. If you look at those six African countries, you see a very clear commitment over a decade of investment in agriculture. So a large part of the revival of those economies has been driven by investments in agriculture. And it makes sense because Africa is largely rural, so by virtue of being largely rural, the economy and agriculture are one and the same. It's hard to grow the economy without growing agriculture. It's also hard to grow agriculture without growing the overall economy. And this suggests that the future really for the continent is going to be driven very much by the decisions that the continent makes in agriculture. And there are at least three things that matter, and two of them have been stressed already quite significantly. One is the role of infrastructure, that you can't grow crops if you can't actually move them. In fact, you can't grow them if you don't have energy or irrigation or transportation. And so there's a lot of attention being paid to infrastructure at the moment. It's projected that over the next 10 years, Africa will have to invest roughly $93 billion in infrastructure to sustain current growth projections. And African leaders meet at least on the average twice a year just to discuss infrastructure. And that has been covered very well in the previous speeches. One area that I really wanted to focus on today is the role of advances in science and technology. There is one aspect of economic transformation that is counterintuitive, which is that latecomers tend to grow faster than frontrunners, which is why we've seen China growing really very fast over a very long period. Prior to that, we saw Southeastern Asian countries growing also really fast. And prior to that, we saw Japan growing faster than Europe. Central Europe grew faster than the UK, which was the home of the Industrial Revolution. And it's a very simple idea, which is that a latecomer inherits a much larger pool of scientific knowledge that has been accumulated by the front runners. So the later you come, the more you can actually harvest. It's kind of counterintuitive, which is the advantage of latecomers. And Africa has this advantage when it comes to agriculture, but even more broadly, economic development. That almost all the technologies that Africa needs to get started have already been developed and are in fact readily available. But there's one little trick that makes it possible for latecomers to make use of existing technologies and improve on them. And that little trick is building technical universities. Because if you don't have technical universities, you have no capacity to know what is available out there. You need young engineers who can say, I can put that together with this and create something new. Just like young engineers in Kenya looked at mobile phones and said, oh, it has capacity to transmit airtime. We can convert that airtime into a currency and then create a whole new industry. So training young people in the engineering sciences is going to be the most critical investment that the continent can actually make. And that comes to the way we design universities, especially agricultural universities. That those universities have to be closer to the farmers. So the universities have to go to the farmers rather than bringing farmers to the universities.
Tonight is I was invited by the embassy, the Malawi embassy? Yes, to attend this ceremony.
And what did you think about the event tonight?
It was great, great, great. The thing I liked about the whole thing was the ideas that have been brought forward, where we are trying, where we've been, where we are, and where we're trying to get in Africa. Because all these resources, and it looks like a lot of people know what you're supposed to do, but right. It's the implementation of them that is very important. So I'm glad our leaders know about it, the presenters know about it, so it's going to be a great opportunity for Africa.
So where do you think Africa is going to be in the next 20 years in terms of business or in terms of economics or in terms of just future growth for Africa's people?
I like the Kenyan gentleman, the keynote speaker, Juma. Because he says Africa is going to benefit from what has already been created. In other words, Africa is not going to recreate the wheel. The wheel is already there,
right.
So it'll be an opportunity to take advantage of that and make it great for Africa. So we're going to be, maybe we'll surpass the development in Asia, maybe America, you never know.
Right, you never know.
You never know.
I love it so much. I've been here last year, so it's my second time here. It's very gracious and it's very valuable for the African countries, and they deserve the better and the best for every moment they're doing well for the African people, and I hope to do better next time, more and more.
And what would you say was the highlight of the event for you today?
Yeah, the highlight, I noticed about the agriculture and food.
Yes.
This was the best I have ever heard about this, especially here in the States. So they are concerned about the African people, and I love that. I love Africa for me.
That's good.
Yeah.
And what do you think about Africa's future? Where do you think Africa is going to be in the next 20 years?
Yeah, Africa actually has a lot of fortunes and treasury, like oil, like gold, like diamonds, platinum, everything in Africa. Only Africa needs somebody to take his hand and be up to the good future. And I have a good faith of a good future for all the African people.
Oh, that's good to hear. I hope you enjoyed yourself here today.
Thank you, ma'am. Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
And even though today's event was about the entire continent, there was a lot of Southern African representation tonight. SACU had its event flyers for its upcoming events here tonight. It also had a table where you could collect information about SACU, our brochures, and we had a lot of people express interest in Southern Africa, and so we hopefully will see them at our next events coming up. One of the highlights for me today was the message that Africa is able to feed itself, that we have enough resources, we have enough food, we have enough innovation, that Africa is able to grow for itself and be self-sufficient. Unfortunately, our night has come to an end, but we did take away from this event that Africa is growing. The continent is growing, the people are growing, and Africa has a brighter future than it has ever before. This is Sininga Kachapandi, and I'm reporting for Southern African Connection. See you next time.